You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good afternoon, and welcome to Gardens of California. My name is Gerald Turney, and I'm your host and instructor. And this is our first show of the fall 2014 semester. We'll have 14 classes, and if you haven't watched this show before and you're not familiar with me, let me tell you a little bit about the class and a little bit about myself. And I'll start with promoting myself. I have a Bachelor of Science in Botany, so a BS in botany from Cal Poly Pomona, where I enjoyed all those years of studying horticulture and botany. And I have a PhD in plant pathology from the University of California, Riverside, where I worked on citrus root rot in a plant pathology laboratory that worked on fungal diseases, particularly diseases of roots. My employment history is I used to be a landscape contractor and a tree trimmer, and after I graduated from UC Riverside, I worked at the Huntington Botanical Gardens, where I curated the camellia collections for 3 years. Then I worked at the Arboretum, Los Angeles County, where I was a research horticulturalist for a few years. And since 2000, I've been a senior biologist, plant pathologist for the Los Angeles County Agricultural Commissioner, Department of Weights and Measures. And I have a plant diagnostic laboratory in Southgate, and people call me up there and ask me about their sick plants or how to water their gardens or what's wrong with their gardens, or maybe just to waste my time. I shouldn't say something like that. But anyway, that's what I do with my day job. I work for the county ag commissioner as a plant pathologist. So now the class is it's really a technical class on how to garden in Southern California particularly, but really all of California or the Western United States to a large extent. And it is live broadcast, and you can call in at 800-339-1193 and ask me questions about your garden. If you've got a problem in your garden, if a plant died, if you planted vegetables and you didn't get any fruit, if the plants collapsed and wilted, or if a tree is dying, you can call in. You can email in questions, you can call in with questions, you can email me photographs of your trees or your problem. That can be very helpful for diagnosis. There's a lot of common problems, and so sometimes just your description will let me know what's wrong. I can let you know what types of products will control the problem, or if there's nothing you can do about the problem, because unfortunately that's the case in a lot of our landscape problems right now. There's not a lot you can do other than remove the plant or the tree and plant something else, which is unfortunate. We are actually right now facing a large die-off of quite a few trees in Southern California from several serious problems. And so a lot of times when people call me up, unfortunately, all I can tell them is your tree is infected and it's going to die. Sorry, that's the hard knocks. Now, since this is, here we are, August 24th, 2014, it's really kind of the end of the summer. We have a few more weeks of summer left, but now is when you're going to transition from your summer gardening to a winter gardening, especially if you're into vegetable gardening or growing some food in your garden. Your summer garden plants are maybe they're at their peak of production right now, so you're not really, don't tear them out now, but in the next 4 weeks or so, you're going to want some space to grow winter materials, because Southern California is a unique environment. And we can grow a summer vegetable garden and then a very productive winter garden as well, although you grow quite different materials in each season. So we'll talk about that today as well. I always like to bring in some disease samples or pest samples, and I've got a number of those to look at today. Plus, I like to have a mystery plant. And so I have the mystery plant, since this is a technical class, I often need to tell you about the terms I'm using and what the terms mean. Now right here, now you can see this tomato back here, that's actually a pest problem. But let's take a look at this. This here is an interesting plant. And you can see it really doesn't even have roots. And this is how they grow. And this is in the same genus. And I'm going to tell you what I mean by genus in a minute. And this is in the same genus right here. And this is in the same genus right here. These are all in the same genus. Now, what is a genus? A genus is a collection of plants that are closely related. And within a genus, and you might have some genera may have one species in the whole genus. Others may have hundreds. And so a typical genus would be a Quercus. Quercus is, all oaks belong in the genus Quercus. There's probably about 600 different species of oaks that grow worldwide. There's about 18 native species of oaks in California. I will have a whole show on oaks later in the season. But today I'm just trying to explain what I mean when I say a genus. Now the genus is always the first name in the Latin name of an organism. I always like to use as an example of a species, man, and the name of man is Homo sapien. Homo is the genus, that's the genus for man. Sapien is what we call the specific epithet. It's not the species, it's the specific epithet. It describes that species within that genus. So sapien actually means wise. That's debatable. How wise we really are. But Homo sapien, the two words together, that's the species, not sapien. You don't say, what's the species for man? You don't say sapien, you say Homo sapien. So in the same regard, if you ask, what's the species for California coast live oak? The species is Quercus agrifolia. There are many other species of Quercus within the genus. So let's go back to our mystery plant. Here's our mystery plant right here. It's a mystery genus. These are all different species within the genus. And it's a pretty big genus. There's quite a few species within it. And they are, I'll tell you a couple little tips. Now, so if you know this genus and you think you know what it is, or if you know the common name for this genus, give us a call and take a guess. We always like to hear from people watching the show. And if you don't have a problem in your garden, maybe you'd like to just call in and take a guess. These are what we call epiphytes. They grow on top of other plants. So there's your mystery genus. Now the other thing, if we could go back just a moment to the requirements of the class for students. This is a class at California State University, Dominguez Hills, and you have to do several things. First off, there'll be two exams. There'll be a midterm and a final. All the questions are taken from the lecture. There is reading to be done to be prepared so you'll understand some of the things we talk about during the lecture, and you'll find them all in the syllabus. And the syllabus has every Sunday what we're going to talk about and a section on reading. And our textbook is the Sunset Western Garden book. And so there's sections of reading for each lecture from the Sunset Western Garden book. When we talk about a genus or when we talk about oaks, you'll read the section on oaks in the Sunset Western Garden book, or you can read the section on oaks on the internet, like in Wikipedia. They have a very good section on oaks in Wikipedia. And there's other sources. You can read any source, just so you understand what we're talking about when we're talking about the oak genus. In addition to that, there are outside events. You need to attend at least one outside event and write an essay describing what you've learned at the event. So you can go to a botanical garden, you can go to a plant society meeting, you know, the Los Angeles Horticultural Society meeting. And so we always start our show with garden events, so you can write down something and attend that. And then you write a little essay saying, well, I went to the Arboretum and I learned about how to grow tomatoes. I went to a tomato lecture. I went to Descanso Gardens and I learned about tulips, or I learned about this or that. And just a little bit about what you learned and where you went. And you submit that essay to me. And so you've got the two midterms, you've got the essay, and that's how you get your grade. So by doing well on the midterm and by submitting the essay. I'm not too strict on on your writing technique. This isn't a writing class. I'm not going to knock you off if you're not a great writer. I really just want to see that you went to a garden event, an outside garden event, and you learned something about gardening in California or Southern California. So you could go to an event that talks about how to mulch gardens or how to water gardens. So let's take a look at our first garden events. And you can put these on your calendar and get out and learn something about gardening and enjoy our wonderful Southern California weather. So at Arden Park, Garden Club Garden Tour is coming up on September 13th from 10 to 2. The gardens will display salvaged wood uses and charming uses of land, including vegetables, flowers, and water gardening. For more information, check the website ardenparkgardenclub.com. That should be a lot of fun. See how other people are gardening and how they're using some recycled materials in their gardens. The Thursday Garden Talks with Lily Singer are coming up September 18th. This is on a Thursday, so some of you may find this hard to attend, but it's a wonderful series. September 18th will be the next one from 9:30 to 12 at the Los Angeles County Arboretum. For more information, give them a call at the Arboretum. That is a paid class, and it is a series, so it's every Thursday, and it goes on for quite a few months. And Lily Singer is a very well-known and respected horticulturist and publisher. She's written quite a bit, and she organizes this whole lecture series, and you can get a lot of very good information on how to garden and on plant materials. And the Arboretum is a wonderful place to visit. In addition to that, we have the South Bay Orchid Society Fall Show and Sale. I wouldn't miss this if you can get to it. This is September 20th and 21st. On the 20th, 11 to 5. On the 21st, 9 to 4. That's a typical format because usually in the morning for these types of flower shows, the judges are looking at the flowers and giving awards. And then when they're done doing that, they open it up to the public. So they'll probably be there early in the morning and 11 o'clock open up to the public. This is at the South Coast Botanic Garden. Check their website, southbayorchidsociety.com, for more information on the show. If you're into orchids, if you want to see spectacular flowers, go ahead and go down to the show. I'm going to do a whole show on orchids later. It's one of our lectures. So a great show to attend. And flower shows, if you like flowers, go to some flower shows. They'll just knock your socks off. In addition to that, we have the Santa Barbara County Horticultural Society Plant Sale. I love plant sales. Unfortunately, I should stop going. I've got too many plants. The annual plant sale, September 27th and September 28th. For more information, contact them at the Santa Barbara County HortSociety.org. And the nice thing about these Horticultural Society type plant sales, whether you go to a plant sale at one of the gardens like the Huntington, or the Arboretum, or Descanso, or Fullerton, or San Diego, and we'll often be talking about events at those locations. If you go to these plant sales, you'll get some unusual plant materials. If you just go to regular nurseries, and they're, you know, wonderful nurseries, I'm not denigrating standard nurseries, but if you're looking for something unique, something different, if you're a real plant person and you want to grow something that no one else has got, or you just want something different. You don't want to grow the same stuff that you see at yard after yard after yard. Then go to these plant sales because they propagate unusual plant materials. They introduce new materials to the trade. And you can grow something different, maybe something more appropriate for your yard, more appropriate for our environment. A lot of the things that we've grown over the last 50 to 75 years since Southern California really exploded in its growth, and all these homes were built all over the place, especially after World War II. A lot of people are living here now, far more than the past. And so everyone was growing a lot of plants that aren't the best plants for our environment. And so where do you find really good plants for our environment? Well, you find them at these different botanical gardens. They are the leaders in developing and finding plant materials that will do well in our environment, that'll give you color, that'll maybe be resistant to some of the diseases and pests that we've got that are perennial problems for us. Anyway, get out there and enjoy a garden event. If you're a student, write me a little essay. You know, there's a variety of ways to get it to me. You can post it on Blackboard. You can email it to me. My email is in the syllabus. And it's a good idea if you're a student, please do send me an email so we can communicate. That's how we communicate these days, is through email, since this is just a TV show and the class isn't sitting in front of me where you can talk to me right after class or interact right during the class. And I encourage all the students to call in and let me know that you're out there and call in with a question. Especially if there's a concept or terms that I'm using that you want a little more depth on or more explanation, call in and say, you said this and that doesn't make sense to me, and explain it a little better. And I'll do my best. So here's our mystery genus. This is a plant that I like to call the plant from Mars. It's not really from Mars, it is from Earth, but it's an unusual, the whole group is really unique, and I brought it in just to share it with you. I grow a lot of those. Now, today's show there's two subjects we're going to talk about. Of course, the class is from 12 to 2. If you didn't know, our class is from 12 to 2. We're going to talk about today how to water a landscape. Why? Well, it's always been important. If you don't water your landscape correctly, it's almost useless to think about what you do next. If you don't water correctly, everything you do after that is useless. It's meaningless. If you're not watering correctly, your garden's going to either be way too wet or way too dry, or it's going to be wet at the wrong times of the year. All these problems that you can have if you're not watering correctly. And I see a lot of talk about watering on the news. Of course, we have this horrible drought. It's been going on for 2 years. And there's a lot of serious consequences for this drought, not just in the agricultural community, but in the landscape and in the horticultural community as well. We're seeing a lot of trees being killed in relation to the drought. So it's a serious problem, and we all need to conserve water. And I see people wasting water a lot in landscapes. You know, most people around their homes, their landscapes use most of the water that they use. The water you use in your bathroom, the water you use in the kitchen, that's probably going to be about 40% of your water use, but about 60% of your water is going to be outside in your garden. Those are the numbers I've always heard over the years, although sometimes I hear that 40% of the water you use is in your garden and 60% is in the house. I've always heard that it's the opposite, 60% in the garden, 40% in the house. So you can dramatically reduce the amount of water you use in your garden if you're watering correctly, and if you re-landscape or choose very drought-tolerant plant materials. So how do you water? Well, there's some very important concepts in watering. And let me see if I've got notes on that. If not, I'm just going to talk about it because I talk about it all the time. I talk about it until I turn blue in the face. Okay, so how do you water? Well, there's two important ideas here. One is how often, and the other is how long. And I'm not going to get into these right now. First, I'm going to talk about the technical aspects of irrigation. Let's first talk about water loss from the soil. You measure that, and we use a term called evapotranspiration, or ET. Evapotranspiration is evaporation from the surface of the soil and transpiration through the plant. And it's called evapotranspiration. Historically, we know what our ET rates are throughout probably all of North America. But since we live in California, let's talk about California. In Southern California, we lose in the hot inland valleys 1 inch a week in the spring and fall and 2 inches a week in the summer. At the beach, it's about 3/4 of an inch a week in the spring and the fall and about 1.5 inches a week in the summer. Out in the desert, it quickly ramps up so that by mid-spring, you're losing 2 inches a week. In the summer, you'll be losing 3 inches a week. In the fall, you'll get back down to 2 or 1 inch. But you notice I'm talking about inches. That's because the way you measure rainfall, and the way you measure irrigation, or the way you apply irrigation to a landscape or a farm or any plants, is by the inch, just the way you measure rainfall. We talk about inches, not gallons. Gallons is not a useful way to talk about irrigating landscapes. It really is almost meaningless to talk about gallons. If I put down a gallon in a square foot, it's going to be several inches deep, thick, of water. If I put a gallon on 1,000 square feet, it's going to be almost no water. So when you talk about gallons, it just doesn't make sense when you're talking about watering a landscape. So we talk about watering by the inch. We talk about ET rates. The next thing is your application rate and how you apply the water. Now, typically people have sprinkler systems. Many, many people have automated sprinkler systems. You can get fancy control panels that get satellite information and control your irrigation. I don't trust them. Sorry. But they probably work pretty good and better than not knowing anything about how to water your garden. But your application rate is in inches per hour. That's what you want to know. If you have a pop-up system for watering a lawn, you want to know how many inches per hour your system applies. How do you figure that out? The easiest way for any homeowner or anybody who has any landscape to maintain is to take coffee cups, straight-sided coffee cups, not ones that curve or anything, but nice and straight, or you could use a tuna can, or you could use any type of container with straight sides that's not too tall. You don't want something like this. You want something low. So, and you put those, you know, maybe take four or five coffee cups, put them out on your lawn, turn on your system for 15 minutes. Go out and measure the depth in all the cups, and then take an average. Now, typically, a pop-up lawn sprinkler with a regular spray head system will apply at about 2 inches per hour. And so in 15 minutes, you can expect to get about a half an inch. So, but it'll vary. It can vary quite substantially depending on the age of your system, the type of spray heads you're using. So you want to figure out how many inches per hour your system applies. And the other thing you'll learn when you put those cups out, especially when you talk about lawns, and I want to say this, and I'll say it over and over again, lawns use more water than any other element in a landscape, including swimming pools. Swimming pools use half the water a lawn uses. Lawns will use, in a hot inland valley, 3 to 4 feet per year of water, easily that much water if you want to keep them alive. Now this year, maybe a little less because we've had a very cool summer so far, and I thank my lucky stars every day that it's not 105, that it's only in the upper 80s. And so really happy it's not a hot, hot summer. But maybe next week it'll heat up. Anyway, so you will learn two things by putting the cups on your lawn and running the system for 15 minutes. You'll be able to calculate your application rate in inches per hour, and you will find out if you have even distribution. For lawns, it's very important to have even distribution. That if you've got 1,000 square feet of lawn and you're applying a half an inch there, that you're also applying a half an inch over here. That you're not applying a half an inch here and a quarter inch over there. And so when you look at your cups and you see one has a half an inch and this one has a half an inch and this one's got a quarter inch, well, there's something wrong with the heads in that area. They might be clogged, they might be facing the wrong direction, and so you've got to go and troubleshoot your system and make sure you're getting even distribution. Now, when you're watering shrubs and trees, even distribution is not nearly as important. In fact, it's really not important. If you soak the ground on half the side of a shrub, it's going to get all that water and it's going to do fine. But if you can't do that in a lawn, because lawns are composed of individual plants, if you have a spot that goes dry, that spot will die and you'll get a dead spot in the middle of your lawn. So you have to have even distribution. Now, so to demonstrate this, I want to show you this, our first clip, which is from the city of Pasadena, actually. It's how to test for landscape water waste. So this individual will show you how to check your application rate and talk about a lot of things about sprinklers. And then we'll talk more about sprinklers. So let's take a look at this clip real quick, and it'll show you exactly what I'm talking about in calculating your water application rate. Let's take a look at this clip.
Hello, I'm Lawrence Budd. I'm an irrigation specialist with the Pasadena Water and Power Conservation Program. Welcome to our video on how to tune up your sprinkler system and measure your outdoor water use. I will guide you through how to measure your water use, show you where you might need improvements, and some better ways to water your lawn and garden. The first thing we're going to do is check for leaks around the house. A leaking toilet or sprinkler valve can waste hundreds of gallons of water every day. So first, check around the house and be sure all the water is shut off. A good way to see if you have any leaks is to simply look at your water meter. See the small black triangle in the middle? It turns for every tenth of a gallon. If it starts and stops, that's good. If it slowly creeps along all the time, that's bad. It means you might have a constant leak somewhere. When was the last time you watched your system run? Heads tend to get blocked, clogged, and broken. So first, let's walk around and see how this system's doing. I see a couple of things in this lawn right away. This brown spot is not caused by a lack of watering, but instead the head is plugged. Here's another one where the head is turned. It's keeping the sidewalk nice and clean, but missing the lawn. And here's one that is completely blocked by plants, preventing the water from reaching the lawn. Now you can buy extensions to raise these heads up, or you can simply cut back the plants, clearing the path for water to reach its intended area. The last most common problem is that the sprinkler head has the wrong nozzle, causing the water to shoot way over its intended area. So the first thing we did was to watch our system run. Then we straightened, unplugged, and unblocked any heads that are giving us problems. Now we're ready to measure the system's efficiency. To do this test, we're going to need 6 cans or cups, all the same size. I'm going to use these small plastic cups. We also need a ruler and a pencil. As you can see, I'm setting up the cups out in the middle of the lawn, in the main watering zone. Try to set them within one zone if you can, and not too close to the heads. Now I'm going to turn the zone on for 10 minutes. We'll see a lot of things happening as it runs. First, the cups are obviously catching water, but some other things are happening as well. Do you see the mist in the air? This tells us that the water pressure is too high and should be turned down. And over here, the zone has only been on for a minute or so, and already we have water running off the lawn. It's sad to know that landscape runoff is the largest single cause of water waste in Southern California. After running the zone for 10 minutes, gather up the cups and lay them out so we can measure the amount of water in each one. Take a ruler and stick it in each cup. We can see that 2 of them have about 1/3 of an inch, 2 have about 1/2 an inch, and 2 have almost none. We're not done yet. Write down the amount of water in each cup. The 2 almost empty ones tells me that this area is not getting enough water, and that means low uniformity. You end up overwatering the entire area just to get these areas wet enough. The right thing to do is to correct the nozzle size or unplug the head so these areas get wet faster. Now we're going to combine all of the cups into one. Grab your ruler again and measure the depth of the water. This is how much water we are applying each hour. In this case, it is roughly 2 inches per hour. That's a lot. Is that good? Well, no, but it's very common. Your soil absorbs water at about 0.2 to 0.6 inches per hour, a whole lot less than the 2 inches per hour we're watering at. So what happens when you water this fast? That's right, you get water runoff. There are guides available to help you set your controller for the correct amount of water based on the kinds of sprinkler heads you have. For more information, please visit our website at PasadenaSavesWater.com. There are a number of things you want to look for throughout the lawn and garden that may help you know if you're overwatering. Is your lawn squishy? If so, it's too wet. Are there moss and mushrooms growing in the lawn or garden beds? If so, your lawn is too wet and collecting too much moisture. Are there stains in the streets and gutters where water's always running off? Or are there standing puddles in the same places all the time? These are all signs that you may be overwatering your lawn. Also, look for any brown or dead spots. This tells you that there's either no coverage in those spots or the head might be plugged. You may even need to add a head for better coverage in that area. I hope you saw some things in this video that can help you improve your lawn and got you thinking about the big causes of water waste. Remember, in Southern California, 60% of all the water we use is used on our landscapes. And never just turn up the watering time to make a brown spot go away. Always fix the problem. I've given you some tips you can do yourself, but landscaping is a craft. For professional landscape advice, we suggest you contact a licensed landscape contractor.
So, He uses a little different technique than I suggested. I suggested, you know, running for 15 minutes and then adding it all up and dividing, then you multiply times four, taking the average and then multiplying by four. He uses six cups, he pulls it all together, but you get to the same result. You want to figure out how many inches per hour you're going to actually be applying with a sprinkler system. So that's typically, with these pop-up spray heads, about 2 inches an hour. And he's absolutely right. Soils will rarely absorb water faster than a half an inch an hour. Now, there are these new low application rate spray heads that you can just switch. You take off the old head, you put on the new head. You don't have to tear out the whole sprinkler system. And they have these little fingers and they rotate like this. And they apply sometimes at less than a half an inch an hour. Now, in a few minutes, you're going to find out that I'm going to tell you to put about a half an inch on your lawn. Every time you water your lawn, you're going to put on about a half an inch. So if you have a system that applies at a half an inch an hour, you're going to have to run that system for 1 hour to get that half inch. And that's kind of the whole point of knowing how many inches per hour you apply, because you want to put out so many inches, either a half an inch, maybe 4 inches. And then you'll know how long to run your system. So we talked about the evapotranspiration rate, that it's, unless really concentrate mostly on hot inland valleys. In the hot inland valleys, it's an inch a week in the spring and the fall and about 2 inches a week in the summer. And then we talked about your application rate and then what else? Now, the other thing to talk about is what we call crop coefficient. And let's go back to that ET rate just for a minute. That ET rate is called a reference evapotranspiration rate. And it is based on how much water a cool season grass will use that's about 4 inches tall in an open field. How much water would a cool season grass, and a cool season grass would be like a fescue. Very popular type of grass for Southern California right now. Marathon, Medallion, those are the trade names they use for them. They are what we call tall fescues. They are cool season grasses. They use the most water, as opposed to something like a Bermuda or a St. Augustine, which are warm season grasses that use less water, need less water than a cool season grass. So if a cool season grass uses an inch a week, that's your reference ET rate. And now everything else is in relation to that, and how we kind of relate that is we use what we call a crop coefficient. So the crop coefficient is a percentage of the ET rate that a given species requires, and the reference ET rate. You know, it's a percentage of how much water compared to that cool season grass. So there are very low water use plants, there are low water use plants, there are moderate water use plants, there are high water use plants. If your crop coefficient is less than 10%, you are a very low water use plant. Things like cactus are very low. They require 10% of the reference ET rate. And they don't need it very often. They can be watered every few months. But when you do water them, you give them a good soak. Because you're going to give them all that water they needed. Say in March, you're losing an inch a week. So 4 inches for all of March. And then March, April, another 4 inches for April for your ET rate. That's 8 inches. So once you get to the point that you can actually put on a few inches, then you're going to water your crop, or you water your cactus. You don't want to. Let's talk also about how many inches does it take to soak the soil to a given depth. The goal when watering landscapes and watering plants is to soak the entire root zone. So where is the root zone? How deep do the roots go? Well, on a grass like a lawn, they'll go 6 to 12 inches. And for most of us, I doubt they get down to 12 inches. So that's shallow rooting depth. For small shrubs, maybe 12 to 18 inches. For medium and large shrubs and trees, you're talking 24 to 36 inches. 80% of the roots in a large tree are in the top 2 to 3 feet. Now, it can vary quite a bit. Depends on how deep your soil is. It depends on If you're in an area with very shallow topsoil, or you're in an area with a very deep topsoil. But in general, large trees are rooted to a depth of 2 to 3 feet, large shrubs and trees. Medium shrubs are going to be probably 18 inches, maybe 24 inches. And then small shrubs, you're looking 12 to 18, and then lawn, 6 to 12. So when you're watering those plants, you need the water to penetrate to that depth of the root zone. So lawns are only rooted to about 6 to 12 inches. So how much water does it take to get down 6 inches? That's a great question. An inch of water will penetrate about 12 inches. And 3 inches to 4 inches will penetrate to a depth of about 3 feet. But it depends on the soil that you're actually applying the water to. And you've often probably heard about having a clay soil, having a sandy soil, having a loam soil. What do those terms actually mean? And we'll talk about that a little bit. But a clay soil needs more water to penetrate deeper. Clay soils have very slow infiltration rates. They don't absorb water quickly at all. And it takes more water to get it deeper in the soil. So if you have a clay soil and you want to penetrate the water to a depth of 3 feet, you're going to need 4 inches of water. If you had a sandy soil, you would only need about 3 inches of water, maybe only 2.5 inches. But sandy soils don't retain water well. Clay soils retain water for a long time. They dry out very slowly. Sandy soils drain rapidly, but don't retain water well. And in the middle, you have loams. And loams drain well, but retain water too. And so loams are your best soils. And let me just talk a little bit about what that actually means. When you say, I have a clay, I have a loam, I have a sandy soil, what does it actually mean? Let's take a look. And I haven't done this in the past because it can get a little complicated. But let's take a look at what I have right here. Let's take a look. And come on and over the overhead and see if we can pick this up. This is called the soil texture triangle. The soil texture triangle is how you determine whether you have a clay soil or a sandy soil or a loam soil. And I guess I need to explain what it actually means. Let's get this in here, right, like that. So this is the texture of the soil. About half the soil is made up of airspace. And the other half is made up of particles. Clay particles are tiny, and they're microscopic. Clay particles are microscopic, less than 1/120,000th of an inch. Silt particles are between 1/125,000th of an inch and 1/500th of an inch. Fine sand particles are 1/500th of an inch, and are between 1/500th and 1/250th of an inch. Medium sand is bigger than that, and coarse sand is up to 1/12th of an inch in diameter. The proportions of these mineral particles determine your soil texture class. Now, clay has a disproportionate influence on the texture of a soil. And so these terms, a clay soil, a loam soil, a sandy soil, a silty sand, a silty clay. These terms refer to the texture of the soil. If you have a lot of clay, you're going to have a clay, because clay has a disproportionate influence. So if you had a 1/3 sand, 1/3 silt, and 1/3 clay, because you got silt, you got sand, silt, and clay. If there was a third of each, you would have a clay soil, because clay has a disproportionate influence. But let's take a look at this chart again. And you can see where the loam falls in. Here's the loam part right here. And so if you had 40% sand and 20% clay, you would have a loam. And if you had, loam is the smallest area in here. Look at this. This is the clay area. So if you have an 80%, let's come down here and get a 40% clay and 40% silt and see where they meet, and you've got a silty clay. So that's what we talk about, the soil texture class. And this is the soil texture triangle. And it, on one, you know, it's got three sides. You got sand, silt, and clay. And so what does that mean for the home gardener or for a farmer or anybody? Well, clay soils are the most difficult soils to work. They are heavy and thick. Once they get wet, they stay wet. When they dry, they turn into rocks almost. They are really hard, and they're hard to re-wet. Sandy soils, the water drains through them very quickly, and they retain very little water. So you water clay soils less often than you water sandy soils. You water sandy soils, you have to water them a lot more frequently because they don't retain the water. If you have a loam soil, then you have the best proportion of airspace. And let me talk a little bit more about the airspace in soils. In the soil, you've got pores, air pores. And you have a distribution. You have micropores, you have little tiny pores that are really, really tiny, and you got a lot of those in clay. And you can have macropores and that are really big, and you got a lot more of those in sand. Macropores drain very quickly. They fill up with, you've watered the soil, the whole thing fills up with water, but the macropores just drain away. The micropores that are retain the water by capillary action. So micropores don't drain well. And so you want a nice distribution of pore space. You want micropores, you want medium-sized pores, and you want macropores. And you want a nice distribution of that because the macropores let the air down into the soil because the roots need air. You want a soil with lots of oxygen, lots of air. That's one of the problems in clays is they have mostly micropores and very few macropores. And so you have a problem with having enough air in the soil. And in sand, you don't have enough micropores to hold on to the water. Loams are right there in the middle. You have equal influence of the three particle sizes. And you have macropores that drain rapidly. You have micropores that hold on to water. That's why loams are so perfect, are the best soils to grow in and work. They don't get hard when they dry out. They don't drain rapidly. They're the perfect soil. So, now I've explained a little bit about the soil aspect of it. So let's talk about water frequency. Now, typically when you're watering trees and shrubs, they are watered generally every 2 to 4 weeks. In the spring, let's talk about citrus and fruit trees in general. Put the tropical fruit trees to the side because they're a little different. But if we're talking about citrus, if we're talking about stone fruits, things like peaches and nectarines and apricots and plums, we're talking about those kind of fruit trees, apples and pears. They typically need to be irrigated once a month in the spring and the fall, and about every 2 to 3 weeks in the summer. And that's kind of dependent on your soil. If you have a clay, you'd go 3 weeks. If you had a sandier soil, you'd go every 2 weeks. And every time you water them, you're going to give them whatever is required based on the ET rate and their crop coefficient. So the crop coefficient for citrus is 2/3. Citrus need, and it's year-round, it doesn't change. So a citrus tree needs 2/3 of the reference ET rate per month in the spring and the fall. So if you had 4 inches, you lost in March. And if you watered your citrus tree 3 inches once in March, you'd give them 75%, you're close enough. Because the actual rate is 66%, you need 66%. But this isn't rocket science. You want to be in the ballpark. The point is, don't water your citrus tree once a week 2 inches and give it 8 inches when it only needed 3 or 4. Okay? And you water citrus once a month and the stone fruits once a month in the spring and the fall. In the summer, you're still going to give it 3 or 4 inches every time you water it, but you're going to do it every 2 to 3 weeks. If you know you have a clay soil, you're going to go 3 weeks. If you know you got a sandy soil, you're going to go 2 weeks. We have a phone call. Let's go to our first caller. Terry, calling from Pasadena, you're on the air.
Yes, I have a question about my vegetable garden. I wanted to know, should I grow vegetables in pots or in the ground? Which one is better? I don't know.
In general, it's better to grow your vegetables in the ground. They will use a lot less water. They will establish better. The pots are fine, but you will end up using more water because pots dry out rapidly. If you do grow in pots, you want to use larger pots, not small pots. You're going to want to use 16-inch or 5-gallon or 15-gallon pots. You're going to use bigger pots. Now, when is it? There's a lot of little things to take into consideration about whether to grow in the ground or grow in a pot. If you don't have a sunny spot where there's ground, say you've got the sunniest part of your garden is paved, or your home. Say on the south side you got a lot of sun, but it's pavement, and you don't have a sunny spot where you can plant in the ground. Well, then you can put pots there and grow your vegetables in the full sun, because vegetables need full sun. They need lots of sun, you know, minimum 6 hours, and that's kind of, you're not going to get great plants at just 6 hours of sun a day. You want 8, 10, 12 hours of sun a day for your vegetables, if you're, you know, tomatoes, cucumbers, your summer materials. If you don't have a spot in your garden to grow them in the full sun, and the full sun is paved, then your pots are a great solution. Use a big pot. But pots dry out rapidly, and so you have to re-wet them fairly frequently, at least once a week. And sometimes in the heat of the summer, like in August and September, you're going to be watering those pots twice a week. If you grow in the ground, you're only going to water your plants about once a week in the summer at the most. And if you mulch heavily, you could probably water every 10 or even every 2 weeks. I haven't watered my tomatoes now for about 2 weeks. And they're not wilted at all. So they've well rooted in the ground. There's a lot of mulch. They don't need to be watered very frequently. So the big advantage to growing in the ground is it's going to use less water to grow your vegetables. And if you do grow in the ground, you can improve the quality of the plants and of your fruit by growing in raised beds, because that will improve your drainage. Pots potentially have better drainage than the bulk soil, but if you break up the soil and mix in a lot of organic material, a lot of compost, and use a raised bed, that's optimum. That's the best. But you need a full sun area where there's dirt. And the reason I say that is a lot of people call me up and say, well, I've got one sunny spot in my whole yard, and that's the only spot I can grow my tomatoes. And so I grow my tomatoes there every year. The other aspect of this is rotation. You don't want to grow tomatoes in the same spot year after year after year. You're going to build up root pathogens or things that damage the root system. And the way you deal with that is by rotating, is growing your tomatoes for a couple years in one spot and then moving to another spot to grow tomatoes, and growing a non-solanaceous crop. You know, tomatoes are in the nightshade family, the Solanaceae, and you don't want to replace, you know, rotate and then grow eggplant there. That's in the same family. They get the same diseases and problems. Or potatoes or peppers. They're all basically the same thing when it comes to diseases and pests. So you're going to want to grow something like a bean there, or corn, or something really different when you rotate. So if you only have one sunny spot in your whole yard, then you want to maybe grow your tomatoes in pots for a year or two while you grow beans where you used to grow your tomatoes. So that's why I say it depends. In general, it's best to grow in the soil directly, but sometimes you can't do that. So then you grow in pots. If you're going to grow in pots, use large pots. And you might want to protect the pots from full sun. You don't want the full sun right on the pot, especially if you have black plastic pots. They'll get really hot in the sun. That dries them out rapidly. So when I do grow, I grow a few things in pots just to grow more stuff. And I put a little board up against the pots so the no sun actually hits the pot itself. In general, grow in the ground when you can. But it's perfectly okay to grow in pots, especially when you want to rotate and get away from a spot so you can grow something else. And a lot of people call me up and they've had continuous problems growing their tomatoes in the same spot. And my first response, well, you have to rotate. You have to grow something. Oh, it's the only sunny spot in my whole yard. It's the only place I can grow tomatoes. Well, find another sunny spot where you can put a pot, you know, and usually you can find that.
Okay. All right, well, thanks for all that good knowledge. Thank you.
Okay, well, thank you for the call. And thank you for watching the show. So, that's a good question. You know, what's better, pots or the soil? Well, some people have very little area in their yard to grow directly in the ground, and so they end up growing in pots. And if you grow in pots, try and use a larger pot. Don't use the soil from your garden in the pot. You're going to have to use a potting mix because pots have their own problems. And if you use regular soil, it will after you get it wet and then it dries, it will shrink a little and it'll pull away from the sides of the pot. Then when you water, it won't water the soil. It'll just run down the sides of the pot and out the holes. And then you can't even water the soil. So you can't put, well, you could, but it's going to be a problem. You shouldn't put bulk soil from the ground into a pot. You should buy potting mix. Potting mix is a little expensive, you know, just $7-$8 a bag. If you had a 15-gallon pot, it's going to take several bags. But that stuff is you know, pretty nice material to grow your vegetables in. You'll get very healthy, vigorous vegetables. But you're going to find yourself watering those pots a little more often than if your plants were in the ground. So we talked about irrigation. We were talking about how often to water citrus and other fruit trees. Now, so citrus have that crop coefficient of 2/3 or 66%. You water them once a month. You water deep. You want to water, when you're watering citrus, you want to get that water to penetrate to a depth of 2 to 3 feet. So you're going to put down at least 3 inches. If you have clay, you probably go with 4 inches. If you had a sand, you might only go with 2.5. If you had a really sandy soil, but then you're going to have to definitely maybe even water a little early, a little more frequently. The thing that'll really help you with your watering in terms of extending the period between irrigations, which is really important to try and do, is to put a thick layer of compost on the surface of the soil, 4 inches thick of compost, underneath your fruit trees. So now let's go back and talk about a lawn. Lawns are only rooted to a depth of about 6 inches, maybe 12, and you're going to need about 1/2 inch up to maybe 1 inch every time you water your lawn. Typically for lawns in hot inland valleys, you're going to water twice a week in the spring and the fall and up to 3 times a week in the summer. Every time you water, I would give them at least 1/2 inch. And that should be just about right for most homes. And that will give you a good, you'll soak the root zone. But because lawns are shallow rooted and that upper 6 inches dries out rapidly, see, the water that gets down 24 inches is going to be there for 2 to 4 weeks. The water in 6 inches is going to be gone in 2 days. That's why lawns are shallow irrigated frequently, and trees and shrubs are deep watered infrequently. That's why you don't grow citrus or other fruit trees in a lawn, because if you're watering for the lawn, you're not watering for the tree. If you're watering for the tree, you're not watering for the lawn. Don't plant citrus in lawns. Now, I mentioned at the beginning of the show, I did my graduate research on citrus root rot. That's caused by a water mold called Phytophthora. There's 2 species of Phytophthora that attack citrus, Phytophthora parasitica and Phytophthora citrophthora. They're called water molds. The number one means of controlling root rot in citrus and really everything else is your frequency of irrigation. How often do you water? If you keep the soil wet all the time, that's perfect conditions for root rot. If you deep water and let it dry out for 2 to 4 weeks, that's how you suppress root rot. So when people, and a lot of people call me up and they are watering every day for 2 or 3 minutes. And let's talk about that, because over the weekend, I went and looked at a lemon tree and the homeowner was concerned because it looked like it was dying. And she was right. It was close to death. And I said, how often do you water? She goes, well, I water once a week with the hose for 2 or 3 minutes. So she sits there and sprays the soil underneath the lemon tree. And in a few minutes, how deep do you think that water went? Maybe 1/2 inch. So she gets about 1/2 inch of soil wet. And the next day, it all evaporates. And this lemon tree is getting zero water. That's really wasting water. Just letting it evaporate off into the air. Just like you saw in that video clip, it's running down the sidewalk into the gutter. That's a great way to waste water. How about only watering the top inch of the soil and then just letting it evaporate? That's a good way to waste water too. So how should you water that lemon tree? Well, you need to take a sprinkler, or there's a couple ways. Let's talk about using a sprinkler first. You put a sprinkler on the end of the hose. You want a low trajectory. If you're going to buy a sprinkler, a hose-end sprinkler, get one with a low trajectory, not one that shoots 10 feet in the air. If you shoot it way in the air, a lot of the water is going to evaporate and be gone. And it's not going to hit the soil. Before that droplet comes and hits the soil, it's losing water to the air. So you want a low trajectory. And so you take your little hose-end sprinkler and you put it on your hose and you set it under your lemon tree or your orange tree or your apple tree or whatever it is, and you turn it on and you put some coffee cups, straight-sided cups, two or three, to catch the water in around where it's spraying. Run that sprinkler until you have 3 inches of water in the coffee cups. Now, it's hard to say what your application rate is because it depends on how much you turn on the hose. Depends on how big the hose is. It depends on what kind of sprinkler you get. Typically, though, I would expect it to take an hour or 2 hours. Maybe even if you have it turned on real low and you have a low flow, it may take 3 hours. You may be applying it an inch an hour. And it'll take 3 hours to water the lemon tree or water the orange tree or the apple tree or a persimmon tree or a pomegranate, whatever the fruit tree. You know, or if you're watering a large pine tree, like, you know, we have a lot of pines we grow in Southern California, non-natives, but very drought-tolerant pines, Canary Island pine, Aleppo pine, Italian stone pine, or our native pines. Again, you're going to water them once a month, but when you water them, you're going to give them 3 or 4 inches of water, and you're going to soak the soil to a depth of 2 to 3 feet, and then you're going to let them dry out for 2 to 4 weeks. And let's take an example of the Canary Island palm, not palm, pine. There's also a Canary Island palm. We'll talk about that later. But the Canary Island pine tree comes from the Canary Islands, right off the coast of Spain. They have a Mediterranean climate. We have a Mediterranean climate. They occur at the same latitude all around the world. So the Mediterranean has a Mediterranean climate, named after the Mediterranean. Southern California has a Mediterranean climate. South Africa has a Mediterranean climate. And what does that mean? It means we have long, hot summers and cool, wet winters. Well, we used to have wet winters, and hopefully we'll get one of these years. But so that tree, the Canary Island pine, which is Pinus canariensis, that's the Latin name for the tree, tall columnar tree with 11-inch needles, very common. You see them all over Southern California, very popular. They're resistant to drought, they're resistant to smog, and they're resistant to oak root rot fungus, another pathogen that's important in Southern California. So a great tree for Southern California, except that pines in general are fire hazards. So I wouldn't grow that in my own yard. And they get to 75 feet. They're tall and columnar. They're very popular. But how often should you water that tree? Once a month at the most. And if you wanted, you could let it go dry all summer. So if you wanted to water one of these trees that comes from a Mediterranean climate, you could water it once in March, 3 inches, once in March, April, May, each month giving it 3 inches, maybe one more in June, and then don't water it in July, August, and September, because in its native habitat, that's what happens to it. On the Canary Islands, they get no rain in the summer. And there's a whole forest of them on the Canary Islands, and they get no rain in the summer months. And in fact, if we get a good winter rains, like in Pasadena, and if you didn't know this, Pasadena averages 22 inches a year. Los Angeles averages about 15 inches a year. And so Pasadena gets a pretty good amount of rain. Mount Wilson, which is up above Pasadena, gets 50 inches of precipitation a year, mostly in the form of snow. And there's a forest up there. And the reason there's a forest up there is there's enough water annually to support a forest. So if we get that normal rainfall in Pasadena or in the San Fernando Valley or all of Southern California, then you don't even need to water Canary Island pines at all. If they get good and soaked in December, January, February, that's good. They're good for the rest of the year. Now, they'll perform a little better in the landscape if you water them once a month the rest of the spring. So So in general, you're watering large trees once a month. Fruit trees, once a month in the spring and the fall, and every 2 to 3 weeks in the summer. Shrubs, well, there's a lot of different kinds of shrubs. It's hard to generalize on shrubs. Some, you know, highly drought-tolerant shrubs, rosemary, juniper. Well, I would, you know, rosemary, you could water it once a month in the spring and the fall and about every 2 weeks in the summer. If you're down at the beach, you could water it once a month and then every 3 weeks in the summer. If you're out in the desert, out in Coachella, Palm Springs, you may have to, you know, sandy soil, you may have to water it every week. So you have to look at your environment, where you are, how hot it is, you know, and then figure out. And let me also emphasize that these are guidelines. Every landscape uses a little different amount of water compared to other landscapes. And it has to do with the soil. It has to do with how much sun it gets. Let's take a lawn in the San Gabriel Valley in Pasadena. And on one side, on the west side, it's got a tall trees. So the sun comes up from the east. It gets sun all morning. And then in the afternoon, it gets shaded. It's going to use less water than a lawn without those trees. They get sun all day. So the lawn in front of my home that is on the west side of my house, that's a hot side of your house. The west and south sides of your house are the hot sides. The east is cool. The north is the coolest. So a lawn that gets sun all day will need at least a half an inch every time you water it. And you'll probably have to water it 3 times a week in the summer. But a lawn that gets shaded in the afternoon may only need to be watered twice a week. So these are guidelines. You notice that he said if you walk on your lawn and it's spongy and wet, well, you're watering too frequently. You're keeping it wet all the time. So you have to go out and look at your lawn and determine if you're watering too frequently or if you can add another day to your schedule. Now, just because a timer defaults to every day for 10 minutes doesn't mean you're supposed to water every day for 10 minutes. Timers have a default that if they lose their program, they go on every day for 10 minutes. That's just to keep everything alive until you get back and put in the correct schedule. And you have to change your schedule. You have to change it probably on March 1st, beginning, you know, that should be the beginning of spring here in Southern California. And then you're probably going to change it on July 1st. And then you're going to change it back on October 1st. Because if you don't have a lawn, by the way, you don't need an automatic sprinkler. The only thing in a lawn, in a landscape, that needs to be watered automatically to free yourself and make sure you're getting watered correctly is really a lawn. If you're just watering trees and shrubs, if you have mostly trees and shrubs, you can leave for a week, 2 weeks, even 4 weeks, and you don't have to have anyone come in and water your lawn for you, and you can water the whole thing just using hoses and hose-in sprinklers, or just have a manual sprinkler system that you turn on. Put the cups out, run it until you get the certain number of inches you want. Now let's talk a little bit about watering a native oak. Let's go back to the California coast live oak, the most common oak growing in Southern California. That, of course, it doesn't need any summer water, and it's best not to give it any summer water because of oak root rot fungus. And we'll talk about more of that, about that when we talk about our native oaks. But how would you water a native oak? Well, if we had a normal winter, I wouldn't water it at all. If we got a good rain in January and February, and we got, you know, Pasadena got 20 inches that year, I would not water my oak at all. I'd let it go dry the rest of this, you know, I wouldn't give it any water in March, April, May, June, or at the summer. I'd let it go dry. That's its natural condition. If we have a dry winter, like we've had the last two winters, where we had only about 5 inches the whole winter season, then I would start watering as soon as I realized we're having a dry winter. So if we went all of December with no rain, I would probably go ahead and water it the first week of January, and I'd give it 3 to 4 inches of water. I would, you know, I'd put a sprinkler underneath it, I'd turn it on, I'd put out cups, I'd run that sprinkler until I have 3 to 4 inches of water in the cups. If it didn't rain the rest of January, like last January, I'd do it again the first week of February. That's what I would do with a native oak. Now, if I didn't realize it until the end of the winter, I'd water it in March once, I'd water it in April once, I'd water it in May once, and maybe water it in June, maybe not. Usually a good soak for 3 months in a row, that's plenty for a native oak. So if you gave it, say you gave it a, gave it the 4 inches, which I would never give anything more than 4 inches, 4 inches, three times, 12 inches. That's all the water you need to give a native oak. And you'd only do it during drought years. Excuse me. So let's compare that to a lawn. If you add up how much water a lawn will use at, say, an inch a week in the spring and the fall, and an inch and a half a week in the summer, that's between 3 to 4 feet of water. So 36 inches of water compared to 12 inches of water for an oak tree. And in the oak tree only when it's a drought year. So now, and if you're growing other drought-tolerant trees, let's take, for instance, olive trees, incredibly drought-tolerant tree. I would only water them if I had to water them. I would water them once in March. I'd skip it in April. I would water them in May. I would skip June. And then I would water them once a month in July, August, September. And then I would skip October. And I'd water them once in November. And hopefully, it'll start raining in December, and I won't have to water them at all in December, January, or February. But olive trees are very low water use plants. And let me show you a couple of publications. Let's go to this one first. And let's go overhead and take a look at this. This is from the University of California. And this is a little more detailed than my lecture has been so far. But it covers some of the same things I just talked about. Well, let's go to the overhead. And here we go. This is a lawn watering guide for California from the University of California Agricultural and Natural Resources Division. So it says how to use, it says determine what type of lawn you have. This is important because a tall fescue, the crop coefficient is actually 80%, and a St. Augustine or Zosia grass, Bermuda grass, those are warm season, their crop coefficient is 60%. So they use 25% less water than a tall fescue. Determine the output of your sprinklers. And you can find this online quite easily. And it talks about putting out the cans. Determine how many minutes you need to water your lawn each week. And they break down the state into various geographic regions. 11 geographic regions, they show them all here. And it shows that Los Angeles is region 10, Southern California inland valleys. 9 is Southern California coast. Go here, and it's got these Northern California, and here are the different regions. And it's showing you minutes per week to irrigate if your hourly water sprinkler output is, and here under 2 inches. Let's go ahead and look at for interior valleys. Here's 8. Here's 9 and 10. Okay, I realize that you probably can't see these numbers. But if you were to, it says minutes per week to irrigate if your hourly sprinkler output is, that's what it says right here. And so in 15 minutes, it says minutes per week to irrigate if your hourly sprinkler output is. And this is cool season and this is warm season. These are two different grasses. So here it says for the warm season, you'd only water 11 minutes for the whole week in January. That would give you a little less than half an inch. Here they tell you to give it a full half an inch for the cool season grass. This would be for the tall fescue. This is for Bermuda and St. Augustine. Let's come down here to July. You're going to have a 27-minute run time for the whole week. I would do that in, I'd just give it 2 15-minute runs. Here they want 36 minutes. Now this is really fine-tuning. What I'm trying to get to you is that, you know, if you did 15 minutes twice a week in along the coast, that'd be all you need. Even in July, August, you see, you can really get away at the beach just twice a minute, 15-minute run times, giving it about a half an inch each time. Let's go down here to the warm season. Come on back to here. And you need, for a warm season grass, you need a 40-minute run time at 2 minutes at 2 inches per hour in July. So if you did 3 15-minute, or you know, you could do 3 14-minute runs. If you had a cool season grass, you'd have to run it for 55 minutes per week and in 3 applications. So if you look up this document, it's from the University of California. So that's what it talks about, the different regions. references. So this is a really good document. This is a lawn watering guide for California from the University of California. The next thing I want to show you is how complicated it can get. This document here, if I can get the whole thing up, is really quite large, and it's meant for or landscape managers and specialists. Say you're a golf course manager and you're managing hundreds of acres and you have to irrigate the whole darn thing, or a park, or just a large area you have to irrigate, and it's mixed. You've got grass, you've got bushes, you've got different kinds of bushes. How do you do it? Let's go to the overhead, and I'll just show you the cover here. This is the estimating irrigation water needs of landscape plants in California, the landscape coefficient method. And this goes through a way of taking the different crop coefficients for each species, averaging them, and then figuring out how many inches per week and how often per week you're going to apply. The really nice thing about this document is at the back, and I'll just open it up here. This is actually the common name section. Let me flip this over and see if I can get to the other section I wanted to get to. Here it is. Now they rate all these different plant materials, and they have hundreds of them in here, hundreds of different species of plants in here. Let's stay on this page. I know it's boring, but that's the way it is. So up here at the top, it says regional evaluations, and you've got five or six regions. And I'll talk about the regions in a second. And this is pelargonium, is a garden geranium. It's low water use, which is less than 30% crop coefficient. In regions 1 and 2, it's moderate water use in regions 3 and 4. They don't have it for 5, and moderate for 6. Ivy geranium, it's moderate all the way across. Let's go to where they explain the difference between moderate, low water use, and moderate. Let me see if I can find that section. So this is a great document, especially, here it is, the key to the symbols for the waters. So let me see, maybe here. So those are the keys, but as I recall correctly, here it is, it's gonna be on this page. Yeah, it's not the right page. Come on. Here are the regions. North Central Coastal is 1, Central Valley 2, South Coast 3, South Inland 4, High and Intermediate Deserts is 5, Low Desert is 6. So this is really great for us, for California. But I wanted to show you the definitions of low water use. And, okay, high water use is 70 to 90% of ET. Let me see if I can get this. Here it is, right here. So high water use is 70 to 90% of ET. Moderate is 40 to 60%. Low is 10 to 30%. Very low is less than 10% of evapotranspiration, the reference ET rate. So if we go back over here and look under these plant names, you can see for geranium, it says low, which is going to be like less than 30%. Moderate is that 40 to 60% of ET. And so you can look up the plant material and see exactly what it says in this document. It's really excellent. And this is really made up for a lot of professionals got together and discussed the water use needs. And it introduces another interesting concept, is that a plant grown at the beach could be low water use, but if you grow it in Pasadena, it may be moderate water use. It needs more water. The crop coefficient is going to be different in Pasadena than it is in Santa Monica. So, and certainly, you see you have just a complete different environment in Santa Monica. It's cooler, but you probably have sand or sandy soils. Although, depending on what neighborhood, you might have a clay. So anyway, this is the estimating irrigation water needs. The other one I wanted to show you is this document here. And this is a really nice one. Let's go to the overhead. And this is from the Los Angeles County Handbook. And this is the Drought Tolerant Garden, Los Angeles County Handbook. And they talk about a lot of designing Let me probably back up a little bit to show the whole page, if you can. But it talks about a lot of really nice things, really, really nicely done. It shows, it gives you a lot of lists of different plants. It shows you how to design them. Really nice if you're thinking of, you know, talk about ground covers, talk about rain gardens, different grasses. So this is a really nice document you can download quite easily. Just go to Google and put in the Drought Tolerant Garden Los Angeles County Handbook. Print it out or just read it right there on the screen and save yourself some paper and ink. So I wanted to share this with you because I think it's a really excellent document. And it gives you a lot of good plant materials, a lot of good names. Now, let's go to our next video. This is Water-Wise Landscapes, Manual and Automatic Sprinklers, Scheduling, Part 1. And let's take a look at this video. And then when we come back, we'll talk. Maybe we'll switch gears a little bit and talk about the types of plants you should be planting in the next 4 to 8 weeks.
If you don't mind a little exercise, a manual sprinkler can be a very efficient way to water, as long as you follow a couple of guidelines. Try to find a sprinkler that matches the area you want to water. Many sprinklers have spray patterns that can be adjusted. And oscillating sprinklers tend to water with larger droplets, so less water will evaporate. For very small areas between hard surfaces and structures, it may be easier to water by hand. A common source of leaks is where the hose attaches. Over the watering season, this can really add up. These leaks are usually caused by a worn out or missing washer. This is an easy repair. There are two types of washers, flat and O-ring. Installing an O-ring washer will generally fix the leak. Great! No leaks. The biggest problem that most people have with a manual sprinkler is forgetting to turn it off. You can buy a simple timer like this one that will automatically shut it off. If you use a timer, you must also install a vacuum breaker between the timer and the hose. The vacuum breaker ensures that no contaminated water can accidentally be drawn back into the plumbing of your home. As far as determining how long to run your manual sprinkler, watch the scheduling section and we'll show you how. Manual watering is a hands-on and effective way to water. If you're an avid gardener and in tune with your landscape, it's a great option. Now let's move on to automatic sprinklers. Automatic sprinklers make watering convenient, but there are opportunities for problems. We're going to show you what to look for and how to address any problems you find. It's important to inspect your sprinkler system at the beginning of each season and monthly after that. Damage can occur from lawnmowers or vandalism or through normal wear and tear. If you don't check your system frequently, you may not know you have a problem. Before you begin your inspection, visit our website and download a system inspection form. Sprinkler systems have four main components: the backflow prevention device, the controller, underground lines, and sprinkler heads. The backflow prevention device keeps contaminants from being drawn through your sprinkler into your home's plumbing. Check with your water utility to learn about requirements. Controllers, also called timers and clocks, come in many models, but they all perform the same function to run your automatic sprinkler system. To do your inspection, you'll need to run your system for a short time. Many controllers have a test option that will run each area for about 2 minutes. Now let's make sure we understand how to use this feature. Turn the dial to the test mode. The display will show test and the time each zone will run. The default runtime is usually 2 minutes per zone. This should be enough to do the inspection, but you can increase or decrease the runtime by pressing the up or down arrows. Next, press the start button, and we're ready to start the inspection. For most residential systems, sprinkler heads come in two basic types: pop-up spray heads and rotor heads. Pop-up spray heads are usually used in shrub beds and small lawn areas. Rotor heads are more often used in large lawn areas. The two types vary in how much water they apply, so you should know which type you have. You should also check every sprinkler you have in your system to make sure they're working properly. Now we're going to take a look at some of the common problems. Sprinkler heads can be knocked off by lawnmowers and weed trimmers. This is a major waste of water and is unhealthy for your plants. If you find a geyser, turn your system off and call an irrigation professional right away. Overgrown shrubs can block the spray. In most cases, this is a really easy fix. Simply trim back the plant. If that is not an option, an irrigation professional can install a riser or move the sprinkler to another location. Sprinkler heads can be turned the wrong way, applying water to the pavement or against your house. You can usually fix this by rotating the sprinkler head back to its correct position. However, if the sprinkler head won't easily turn, don't force it or it could break. If the system pressure is too high, the sprinkler heads will mist and the water will evaporate. This can be fixed by lowering the system pressure, but that's a job for a pro.
So she's showing you those various types of heads. The one head that I wish she had with those little fingers that have very low application. The problem with a lot of those heads is their application rates are way too high. And so you're putting down 2 inches an hour at that rate. And you know, there is a website that the city of Los Angeles operates from water and power called bewaterwise.com. And if you go to that website and you put in the type of plant material you're watering, and they give you three choices: high water use, medium water use, or low water use. Then you put in your zip code, and then you put in your water application rate in inches per hour. Excuse me. And then you say calculate, you click calculate, and it gives you a water schedule. So it's a really nice website. I've used it and looked at it, but what you'll see is if you put in 2 inches per hour, it will give you a schedule that says, you know, 3 minutes, five times a day to get your 15-minute runtime for your lawn. So it'll be 3 minutes at 8 o'clock, 3 minutes at 8:30, 3 minutes at nine, you know, and because if you run it more than 3 minutes, it's gonna start running off. So, you know, that bewaterwise.com is a great spot, but what it reinforces to me is that you need to lower your application rate, because most timers will allow you to turn on one valve three times in one day. Now you can turn it on three times, you know, in one day and three times tomorrow, and you know, but the point is, say you wanted to water for 15 minutes, your lawn for 15 minutes, and if you run it for 15 minutes, a lot of that's going to run off. Either you got a slope, which is a tremendous runoff problem, or you're just, you know, you're applying it at 2 inches an hour and it's going to run off. So you can break that into three applications of 5 minutes and give it about, you know, 15 to 30 minutes between each runtime, and then you'll greatly reduce your runoff because you'll give it a chance to soak in, then you give it another 5 minutes. But what you'll notice with those high application rates on the bewaterwise.com website, which you see right in front of you now, is that when you have those, they'll give you sometimes as many as 7 start times to get your total runtime for the whole day. So the last time I did a sprinkler system at my mom's house, I used those little heads that apply at about a half an inch an hour. You got to run them longer, and that's fine. You eliminate that runoff, and that's what you really want to do. So now we actually have a part two of that same video. Let's go and take a look at part two of that same video. Hopefully we're ready with that video. Maybe not. Okay, if we're not ready, I could look at some disease problems that we had come in before we talk a little bit about fall planting. Let's hold, stand by. Let me just pull up something here. Now, you know, I have a lot of tomatoes in my garden this year, and one of the real problems that I get every year on my tomatoes, we'll just step away from water for a second here, is spider mite. And if we come in close, I don't know how far we can come in here. I want to just show you how to spot spider mite. It's one of the easier things to notice, and it will devastate your tomatoes. Come in close. Get a close-up of this if you can. But if you notice, there's some fine webbing. I don't know if I can show you this, but first off, you can see it's kind of speckled yellow, and there's very fine webbing all over this. And if we hold this up, you can what you'll see is very fine webbing. You can see little orange spots all over it. That's showing up pretty good. You can see the discoloration in the leaves. It's all speckled. And then there's this fine webbing. And I don't know if you can see the webbing really clearly but this is spider mite. This is fairly easy to control with either soaps or oils, like Volk oil or Sunspray Ultrafine oil or neem oil. Now a lot of the oils they're selling are canola oil or mint oil. All the oils are non-toxic to mammals, and the way they kill mites, which are not insects, they're arachnids, they're related to spiders and ticks, but they get killed the same way by oils. It smothers them, it prevents them from breathing, so oils are very effective. You can't use oils when it's over 90 degrees, or it'll burn the foliage. You can use soap, you can use dishwashing soap, or you can buy insecticidal soap at a local nursery or garden center. You usually need to spray about once a week, or even twice a week. If you notice it and it's gotten away, you're going to need to hit it like twice a week. And you're going to have to spray two, three, even four times to really get it under control. But this is when they kind of explode, is midsummer. I don't get mite problems in March and April. I don't get my mite problems until about the beginning of August. And so a couple of my plants are pretty badly infested right now, and I need to get down and spray again. I sprayed several times, but I've got quite a bit of tomato this year. So that's spider mite on tomato, real common problem. And if you don't control it, it'll ruin your tomatoes. You got to get right on it. Now we got part two of that video is ready. Let's go back to that video.
Now that you know your sprinkler's watering rate and how to fine-tune your schedule based on the soil, let's learn some basics of how to program your controller. As an example, let's schedule your controller to run 3 days a week, Monday, Wednesday, Friday, 10 minutes each time. Start by choosing a program at the day cycle. Now choose when to start your sprinklers at the program start time. Next, we pick which days to water. Turn the dial to Monday and use the arrow keys to turn it on. Turn the dial to Tuesday and turn it off. Continue this way through the rest of the days of the week. Now we need to program how long to run each zone. Turn the dial to one zone at a time and use the arrow keys to set the time. Keep in mind that grass and shrubs have different watering needs, so the run times won't be the same for every zone. Many controllers have a variety of features that help you use water efficiently. The cycle and soak feature breaks the run time into two or more periods, so the soil has time to absorb the water. Here's how to set it up with this controller. First, pick a new program. Go to Program Start Time and set two separate start times for the program. Set the run times for each zone you want to program using Cycle and Soak. Controllers vary from one model to another, so look at your owner's manual or talk to an irrigation professional for more information about your controller. We've looked at a number of ways to spot and fix problems with your sprinkler system. Now we're going to look at some hardware upgrades that will put your system on the cutting edge. Today's controllers have a variety of functions that make it easier to manage your sprinkler system. Some have soil moisture sensors. Others use current weather data to automatically match the changing needs of your landscape. If your controller is more than 7 or 8 years old, consider upgrading. You've probably heard of drip systems. Drip systems apply water slowly and directly to the root zone instead of spraying the water in the air where it can evaporate. Drip systems are great for vegetable gardens and shrub and flower beds. Some drip lines have built-in water emitters, which is great if plants are equally spaced. It's okay to cover the drip line with mulch, but don't bury it in the soil. Another type of drip is microsprays. Microsprays are very small sprinklers that water exactly where you want to. They're easy to add or move, and you can even adjust the water output to meet the changing needs of the plant over time. A rain sensor is a device that shuts off your sprinkler system when it rains. Rain sensors are inexpensive and can be easily installed on most automatic sprinkler systems. Visit our website to learn more about rain sensors. Some new sprinkler heads have high-tech features that use water very efficiently. This one has a built-in check valve that prevents water from draining once the sprinkler has shut off. Ask your irrigation professional about upgrading. When you're upgrading, look for the WaterSense label. The WaterSense label means the product has been certified for efficiency and performance. There's a lot of new irrigation technology to keep your landscape vibrant and beautiful while still using water efficiently. I hope you found this information helpful. Let's briefly recap what we've covered. No amount of water or fertilizer will make a plant healthy if it's in shallow or poor soil. Amend your soil with compost, especially if it is heavy in clay or sand. Plants are like people. They each have their own likes and dislikes. Get to know the soil, sun, and water needs of your plants and place them accordingly. Make it a habit to inspect your sprinkler system in operation at the beginning of each season and each summer month. If you find problems, take care of them as soon as you can. Weather is always changing. That means your landscape's water needs change too. Learn how to schedule your controller and update it monthly or more often based on weather conditions. Watering the air or the pavement doesn't help your plants, and it costs you money. Focus on getting water down to the root zone. When in doubt, take your shovel and have a look. There is amazing new irrigation technology to provide your plants just the right amount of water. If your system is outdated, look for new sprinkler hardware. And if you don't have a rain sensor, get one. Visit our website to find the forms referenced in this program, as well as other resources to help you conserve water in your landscape and home. Attractive lawns and gardens are a wonderful asset to your home and family. You can have a beautiful landscape and save water. I'm Paulette with Cascade Water Alliance. Thanks for watching and happy gardening.
You know, I can see where a rain gauge or a rain sensor would be very appropriate for the Pacific Northwest. I just don't think we get enough rain to really make it all that useful for Southern California. Of course, you can go out and turn off your system when it's raining. Maybe I'm just pessimistic because it seems it never rains here anymore. So, no one's guessed our mystery plant, so I want to talk a little bit about it and tell you what it is. This is in the genus Tillandsia, and tell you the truth, I've lost the tags on some of these. So this is a Tillandsia. This is a different species of Tillandsia right here. Here is a different species of Tillandsia. They're called air plants. This one I always remember. It's called Tillandsia bulbosa. These usually grow in tropical areas, South America, Central America, and they grow in the canopy of trees. They are actually quite drought tolerant, and the way they don't have any roots, they usually grow on top of stuff. They can grow on telephone lines. They can grow on top of cactus. And the way you water them is you just mist them. You can set them in your sink and spray them with a little spray nozzle from your sink, or you can set them in a bucket of water. And in fact, if you let them go dry a long time, they'll kind of shrivel up. You may, you know, not water them for a month. And if you drop them in a bucket of water, they'll puff right back up. So they can go through long periods of drought, and they survive that. And if they get wet, they just puff right back up. The real fun thing to do is to tie them onto a log or some type of branch. You can tie on several species. They don't really want to be, they'll take full sun, but I would grow them where they get morning sun and afternoon shade, or under shade cloth. I grow most of mine under shade cloth, so they get partial sun, or they get shade, but bright shade all day long. And they are in the bromeliad family, so they really are bromeliads. The typical bromeliads have a cup, and you just fill the cup with water. These really don't have cups, but they have similar flowers. This one already bloomed, and it takes a long time for this to bloom. You can see the little old brown bloom here, but now it's sending out new pups down here at the base. Here's the flower from the original plant, and it's sending up new plants. So often, you know, tillandsias will become big balls, and you can hang them, and when they bloom, they'll have these bright red inflorescence with little purple flowers. And so they're really fun. They do quite well. You can grow them in apartments with a bright window. So it's a nice apartment plant. A lot of people call me up and say, what can I grow in my apartment? You know, it's dark. It's not very well lit. I don't have a balcony, or, you know, I might have a balcony, but it doesn't get a lot of light. The tillandsias are excellent. So are bromeliads. The whole bromeliad family, bromeliaceae, are nice house plants that will tolerate low light conditions. They do best with a little bit of morning sun, and then protect it from the hot afternoon sun. If you're at the beach, they'll take a little bit more direct sun in the afternoon. It doesn't get that hot. But if you're in Pasadena or the San Fernando Valley, out in Riverside, or you know one of the hot inland valleys, I wouldn't put these out in the full sun in August and September, when we can shoot up into the low hundreds, or even over 105, 110. That's awful hot, and that'll be pretty rough on them. They might burn in that type of sunlight. But this one started out as just one plant, and now it's several, it's a big clump, and that's what happens over time. If you grow these for a long time, they keep sending off pups off the base, and they get bigger and bigger and bigger, and they keep blooming and look really nice. So this is tillandsia. This was our mystery genus, and I've lost the species on this. There's a wonderful tillandsia nursery in Torrance. It's called Rainforest Flora and Botanic Garden, and actually that's where I got my tillandsias, but there's other places that sell tillandsias too. And we have a native tillandsia in the southern United States, from Florida all across the south, which is Spanish moss. That is a tillandsia, and it grows off, hangs off branches of trees. And there may be some other tillandsias that actually grow in Florida too. I'd have to go back and read more about that. But so this is tillandsia, and this one, I do remember the species on this, tillandsia bulbosa. And this is the one I like to say is the plant from Mars, because it's so unusual. It's so cool. So that's tillandsia. And now I wanted to talk also about transitioning from your summer garden to your winter garden. And there's a lot of things you can grow in the winter. Now, typically, the best time to start your winter garden is in mid-September. About September 15th is the earliest you want to plant. The last 2 weeks of September is the perfect time to get in winter materials. So one of the basic winter materials is peas and snap peas. And if we go to the overhead, I'll show you a couple bags of pea seeds I've got here. This is Asian vegetable is just the label on it, but it's this should be a snap pea here. This is a snap pea or a sugar pea. You eat the whole pod. So if you get these in mid-September or October, then you can be picking peas probably by late December and into January. It's too hot here in the summer for peas, so peas are a winter material. Other things to grow in the winter, here's your more pea seeds here. So these are two different varieties of peas. And just see what else we've got now. Lettuce, all sorts of lettuce. This is a mixed thing, a burpee lettuce gourmet blend. So lettuce is always best grown in the winter. You can grow summer lettuce. Now, if you're going to grow head lettuce, you have to grow head lettuce in the winter or it won't head up. Cabbage, broccoli, cauliflower, Brussels sprouts, these are all winter materials. Spinach, that's a winter material. So if you want to grow spinach, and also some of the herbs that you might want to grow, especially cilantro. If you grow, you know, what happens when you grow those, if you plant those next spring and grow them in the summer, they will flower very rapidly. As soon as we get long days, boom, they flower and they make their flower spikes, and then they're not going to grow the leaves. And we eat the leaves, of course, on the peas, we eat the peas, the actual fruit. But when you're growing the lettuce, you're eating the leaves. And so on the short days, they don't bloom. You know, your lettuce won't bloom until March. So if you plant, and you can sprinkle lettuce seed out, and you turn the soil, flatten it out, sprinkle the seed in, get it good and wet, cover it with a little bit of mulch, and the seeds will come up everywhere. The nice thing about growing from seed, and I'm growing more and more of my plants, especially my vegetables, from seed. There's two advantages. One, it's much cheaper. A packet of seed costs a buck or two, and the packs cost $3, you know, for six plants, where a packet of seed will grow you maybe 100 plants. So the cost is much less to grow from seed. The other thing is, a lot of times when you buy those little pony packs that might have six plants or 4 to 6 plants in a little pack, is there's a good chance that you might have some root diseases in there, either Pythium or Rhizoctonia or Phytophthora or something like that. And when you grow from seed, you're not going to have that problem. So when you from the pony packs or planting from nursery plants is a good way to introduce those root pathogens into your garden. The other things that you might want to grow are some winter flowers. And this is, the fall is when you want to get them started, especially if you're going to grow from seed. But here's a couple suggestions is lupins. Now lupins, you can grow them in the winter, plant them now, plant them in late September or October to bloom. And I'll show you this right here. This is a little pack of lupin seed. Lupins are really fun, but you're going to want to get them started in the fall so they can bloom in late February or March. And then these are sweet peas, and sweet peas are fabulous. Again, you got to grow these and start them in the fall. If you get these in around September 15th or within a week or two of that, you can have sweet pea blooms by December. So let's talk a little bit more about peas. You can also do some wildflower mixes. Here's a wildflower mix, two different wildflower mixes. You spread these out in the fall and you'll have them for the spring. Snapdragons are easy to grow from seed. It's a winter material. It's not a summer material. What else? Pansies are a good winter material. The things you can't grow in the summer, marigolds, petunias, zinnias, those are all, you start those in about March, grow them all through the summer, and you take them out in the fall. Now let's talk a little bit about the pea family, because that's also part of today's lecture. And let's see if we have our first pitcher, our first number one pitcher from our set of pitchers. Okay, let's talk about this tree. Let's bring this up full screen. This is called the silk floss. It's Carricia speciosa, and they're blooming around town right now. It's also called the Brazilian thorn tree. And let's see if there's another picture. What's the next picture? Yeah, that's the Brazilian thorn tree. These are taken in front of the Los Angeles County Arboretum. Let's take a look at the next one. And this is why it's called the Brazilian thorn tree. It's got these large thorns, they're probably technically prickles. You can see the label right there. I don't know if you can read it, but this is also in front of the Arboretum. And they bloom this time of year. And they have these bright pink flowers. Let's take a look at the next picture. And after the flowers, they have these big green fruits. And once the fruits pop, they have these big balls of this white fluffy stuff. It's called kapok, so it's also referred to as a kapok tree. And this can be used as stuffing and pillows, so it has a practical use. And let's take a look at our next picture. And this is the pea flower. This defines the pea family. And let me get my notes out for the pea family. The name of the family is the Fabaceae. Yeah, and that's the new name. The old name was Leguminosae. That's right. So Leguminosae or Fabaceae is the pea family. This includes peas, beans, lupins, soybean, and a lot of trees. It is the third largest plant family behind orchids and sunflowers, in line with things like grasses also. The grass family, the Poaceae, is quite large. Flowers, so there's the flower diagram. Bring it up. And flowers can have two types of symmetry. They can be radially symmetrical, which means you can draw a line through anywhere and you get two equal halves, like a sunflower. That's radial symmetry. This is bilateral symmetry. You have to draw the line right like this, only one way to split it. But they have a banner petal, they have the keel and the wing, and then here's the pistil and the few stamens. And down here is the calyx. So here's the keel, here's the wing. And we'll see this. And quite commonly, they are what we call bipinnate, and I'll explain that in a minute, but let me talk a little bit more about the flower before we move on. They have five generally fused sepals and five free petals. They are generally hermaphroditic and have a short hypanthium, usually cup-shaped. They are normally 10 stamens and one elongated superior ovary with a curved style. So the leaves most often are even or oddly pinnate compound or bipinnate. Let's take a look at our next picture and bring that up and bring this up full screen. This is, this is probably once pinnate. And this right here, this whole thing is the leaf. These are what we call, each one of these is a leaflet. And so you can see, the leaf starts here. This is the petiole, and these are the leaflets. And it's once pinnate in that it divides into ones, these like this. And it can also be bipinnate, where instead of this being a leaflet, this is further divided into a series of leaflets. The fruit, the ovary most typical develops into a legume. Let's take a look at a pea pod, our next picture. A simple dry fruit that usually dehisces on both sides or sometimes along a seam. And you can see here, it splits right along here. And here are the individual peas. Many Fabaceae host bacteria in their roots within structures called root nodules. And this is kind of important. And people, a lot of nurseries used to sell it, and the bacteria is called rhizobia. And rhizobia attaches to the root hair, and then the root grows around it in a way, and you get this nodule. And inside that nodule, the bacteria, the rhizobia bacteria, is fixing nitrogen from the air and turning it into a nitrogen form that the plant can use. So this is a mutualistic relationship. It's symbiotic in that it's closely, they're living close in close association, but symbiosis can mean good, bad, or neutral. And so with peas, this is a mutualistic, it gives a place for the bacteria to live, and the pea plant feeds the bacteria food that it makes in its leaves, and the bacteria fixes nitrogen from the air and provides it with a nitrogen source. And in fact, if you fertilize peas, you'll suppress that natural relationship. So when you plant peas, if you're going to grow sugar snaps or any type of pea or even beans, you want to give them a little fertilizer when you plant the seeds, but not too much. If you give them a whole lot, you'll suppress nodulation. And the other thing, especially if you're going to grow some my mind is just kind of gone flat, is these sweet peas. Or the regular snap peas, the China peas or the snap peas. You dig a trough, a little trench, and then you put the seeds in it. And you're only going to put them about an inch deep or so. It'll say on your seed packet how deep to plant them. Cover that with like vermiculite or perlite or a very, very light mix. If the soil crusts, when it starts to push up, it can break the hypocotyl. And so for peas, to get them to come up through the soil, you don't want a hard surface above the seed. So you really want it to be fluffy and light, and it'll come right up. It'll give you your planting distance. Usually, if we take a quick look at on these sweet peas, it says, let's see here. So seeds 1 inch deep and 1 to 2 inches apart. When seedlings are 4 to 5 inches tall, thin to not less than 6 inches apart. So, you know, I've had such high germination rates, sometimes I just go ahead and seed at 6 inches apart. But if you seed at 1 to 2 inches apart, you're going to be pulling out a lot of plants, because I find that they, you know, get very good germination. Now, let's take a look at the snow pea. That's our next picture. This is Piscium sativum snow peas. These are one of my favorite peas to grow. Bring this up full screen. You pick these before they puff up. Pick them just at this stage right here and use them in stir fries. You can use them in salads. The one problem you get with peas is powdery mildew. It can be a big problem. Kind of like the same problem, well, powdery mildew problem you get on squash. If you grow squash, zucchini yellow crookneck or patty pan or whatever squash you're growing, you're going to get powdery mildew. And my squash did really well all up until about the end of June, and then the powdery mildew really got bad on them. I had a copper fungicide. I didn't get it on it. I didn't get down and spray them. And so it ruined the plants. Now, I got a lot of squash out of it. I'm not complaining. But if I had treated it, I would have gotten more squash. Now, I had a lot of squash, so I wasn't too upset about it. And so I just let it go. With your peas, you're going to need to scout for powdery mildew. Once you see the first white little fluffy spots on the leaves, you're going to have to use some type of fungicide to control the powdery mildew. Now, you can use milk and water at 10% milk and 90% water, up to 50-50, but you have to spray once a week. You can now use a potassium bicarbonate-based fungicide, organically registered and non-toxic, that's from Kellogg. You could use neem oil. That will work pretty well as well. And I'm trying to think of what else works really well for powdery mildew. Those three should really do it for you. But your spraying has got to be pretty frequent, about every 7 to 10 days. Most of these are what we call foliar protectants. They get on the leaf, and when the spore lands on the leaf, it can't germinate, or if it germinates, it gets killed. With the milk and water, you actually get this layer of milk on the surface of the leaf, and bacteria grow in that, or fungi grow in that layer of milk, and that's what actually suppresses the powdery mildew spores from growing. So that works quite well, any milk product. Some of the people who have used it have told me if they use non-fat milk, they get no smell of sour milk. And if you use whole milk, they can get a little whiff of sour milk. But that has to be sprayed on about every 7 to 10 days. If you get rain, you're going to have to reapply too, because it'll wash it off. And of course, hopefully, at some point next winter, we'll get some rain. Let's just move on and talk more about peas. If you want, bring up the next picture behind me, because it's so pretty. We'll talk a little bit about these sweet peas in a minute. So the history of legumes is tied closely to that of human civilization. Appearing in early Asia, the Americas, the common beans, several varieties in Europe, broad beans by 6000 BC. It's always interesting to think about the fact that a lot of these plants have been grown for thousands of years. Beans were a staple throughout Europe because they are high in protein. So beans are really good, great meat substitute. Beans are one of the longest cultivated plants, broad beans having been known since at least Egypt, from Egypt. Let's bring up our next picture because it's so pretty. This is scarlet sweet pea. The commercial bean has been in cultivation for 6,000 years in the Americas, or the common bean, I should say. Beans were an important alternative source for protein throughout Old and New World history, still are today. There are over 4,000 cultivars of bean on record in the United States alone. Now, beans are generally grown in the summer, not in the winter. Peas are grown in the winter. Most of the kinds are commonly eaten fresh come from the Americas. One of these, the three sisters, squash, corn, and peas. And if you haven't heard of that term before, the three sisters, that's squash, corn, and peas. It's what the Native Americans used to grow. They'd grow corn, and they'd grow peas to crawl up on the corn, and squash all around it to suppress weeds, and it worked quite well for them. The wild pea is restricted to the Mediterranean basin and the Near East. Earliest archaeological finds of peas come from Neolithic Syria, Turkey, and Jordan. In Egypt, early finds come from about 4,800 to 4,400 BC in the Delta area. So you can see that peas have been around a long, long time, and beans. In modern times, however, peas are usually boiled or steamed, which breaks down the cell walls and makes the taste sweeter and nutrients more available. Along with broad beans and lentils, these formed an important part of the diet of most people in Europe during the Middle Ages. In fact, beans were one of the major food sources for people during the Middle Ages. Meat didn't keep, it spoiled. And only wealthy people could probably afford to eat meat. By the 1600s and 1700s, it had become popular to eat peas green. So they used to cook peas, but you can eat them fresh, you know. New cultivars of peas were developed by the English during this time, which became known as garden peas and English peas. Thomas Jefferson grew more than 30 cultivars of peas. Thomas Jefferson was a great horticulturalist. Many cultivars reach maturity about 60 days after planting. So if I plant these on November 15th, I might be picking peas by the end of November if I get these done on September 15th. That'd be fun. So let's talk about, it is a cool season crop. Typically in the rest of the United States, they plant them in early spring and harvest them before the summer. We plant them in the fall and harvest them at Christmas. So the seeds may be planted as soon as the soil temperatures reach, well, that's for cold areas where it freezes. The snow pea, Piscium sativum variety microcarpa, eaten whole in its pod while still unripe, cultivated in a region that is now along the Thailand-Burma border 12,000 years ago. Snap peas, also known as sugar snap peas or mange tout, same species. And I showed you, you know, the seed. So those are easy. There are several cultivars of snap peas, including Sugar Ray, Sugar Bond, Sugar Ann, Sugar Snap. Seeds should be planted 1 to 1.5 inches deep. Let's talk about sweet pea, because sweet peas are so much fun. Let's bring up our next picture of sweet pea. They come in a variety of colors. This is Lathyris odoratus is the actual name. They're native to the eastern Mediterranean from Sicily to Crete. Have been cultivated since the 17th century. Vast number of cultivars are commercially available. They're poisonous. You cannot eat it. Unlike the edible pea, there is evidence that seeds of members of the genus Lathyris, including sweet pea, are toxic. So, Henry Eckford, who died in 1906, a nurseryman of Scottish descent, crossbred and developed the sweet pea, turning it from a rather insignificant, if sweetly scented flower, into the floral sensation of the late Victorian era. So let's take a look at sweet peas. Let's take a look at our next one. We just saw a kind of a lavender. This next one is called Sunshine Opal. Now they need to be supported. They have to have a trellis. Bring our next picture up, which shows a trellis system and people harvesting the flowers. Highly fragrant, and they come in a myriad of colors. Very easy to grow. Now I'm running out of time. I'm not going to be able to show you much more. Show them one more picture of sweet peas. Bring that up behind me if you can. I encourage everyone to grow some sweet peas. There you go. There's a deep red. So they come in many, many colors. Highly fragrant. If you get them in early, then you'll be able to harvest, cut flowers, bring them indoors for Christmas. They'll scent your whole house. So I can't tell you how wonderful sweet peas are. And it's a winter material that you can grow and enjoy this winter and in future winters too. That's been everything for this show. We're dark next Sunday. There's no show next Sunday. We'll be back in 2 weeks. I want to thank everyone in the control room for their hard work and effort to put on the show. And I'm wishing you happy gardening until I see you again.